You want to shut up and call me back?
Yeah, let's try that. Let's try that.
Yeah, let's try that. Okay, now you add her to the call.
Me add Rika?
Yeah.
Rika, are you back with us?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep, we can hear you. Okay, yeah. Back to my question. Yeah, my question was, how were you hired for Castlevania? You know, from, like I said, it seemed to be the first time you worked with Konami. You said that was the first game they were going to produce like this. So, what was the story behind that? Gabe, you still there?
Yeah, I'm here. Yeah, everything... Oh my.
Yeah, we're having some difficulty here.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. this is why Google Fiber needs to be mandatory. Internet speed, 1 gig. Would be perfect for everything.
Is this calling her phone?
Please leave your message for
Rika Muromaka.
There should be a button that says call Skype. I mean,
that's not what I was trying to do, and then it would call her phone.
Oh, that's odd.
Hello.
Hi.
Hey.
Hello there.
Okay. Now we've finally gotten that all taken care of, or hopefully.
For some reason, I tried to call you back a couple times, and it kept calling your phone. I don't understand. Okay, back to where we were.
Yeah, we're...
Get that out of the way. Go ahead and give us the story behind Castlevania. I'm really interested in that one. I'd love to hear that.
I saw the advertisement on a newspaper, like a Wall Street finance. substantial. And the keyboard magazine. I went to my friend's studio and he had a keyboard magazine. I was looking at the keyboard magazine and I saw that advertisement say, can you hear me?
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear you. It keeps cutting in and out again.
Hello?
Hello. Can you hear us?
Let me just do on my phone. My phone might be better.
Okay. Yeah. That's fine.
Yeah, if we're not doing video, we should be fine with that.
Okay.
Yeah, just the audio. I think the audio might be better.
Okay. That'll be fine.
Okay. All right. Okay, hold on.
Man. Oh, my. I don't like the internet. I mean, I do, but I don't.
Yeah, I expected a heavier Japanese accent.
Yeah, so same here, man. Yeah, I mean, it's crazy, man. I think it has to do with their coming over here at, like, so, like kind of a younger age.
Yeah.
You know, 'cause she was studying jazz over here as a teen, if I remember correctly.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, I was going to tell her, I was like, 16 years old, that's pretty young to be in a jazz club.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Okay. Oh,
perfectly.
Oh, this is amazing.
I told you this is better. I keep telling this smartphone is much better than sometimes PC, and it has it. Okay.
All right.
So,
Castlevania.
Okay, let's back to Castlevania. Okay. People always want to know how do I get job at the Konami, because now is so like impossible. If you're trying to get a job anywhere, that's just Konami. But when I started out, the video game was not a real, like, a video game industry, like now. And people were kind of laughing at them, especially record companies. Like, it's like, well, why are you working for, video game company? And they were, like, kind of, like, prejudiced towards record recording industry was kind of, like, really prejudiced against a video game company, because they're like, are you writing for like a Mario type of music? You know, I mean, beep, 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 like real simple. So they were like, they were calling me and laughing. I said, what? Are you not writing for the the music for the record company anymore? What's going on? You know, they were like freaking out, And how I got my job is I saw the advertisement in a newspaper and keyboard magazine.
Okay.
And I saw the advertisement say graphic artist, C++ programmer, and they were looking for about everybody from programmer to sound designer to composer to everybody. So I actually applied for the Konami, put my resume together and music, and I put it out there, and I got a call and said they want to interview me. So I went in, interviewed the guy, and he happened to be the president of the music department at that time, publishing side. And he and I talked for 45 minutes, and I got hired right on the spot. And he told me, yeah, we really need to change the music because we can't really bring Japanese, music to, outside the country, because I know they want different types of music in America. So they were, he was asking me, we really gotta change the music, and we can't really, hit the world unless we have a really good music with video games. So that's where I came in. So he's like, you're perfect, your music is great, because at that time I had a record deal with the international department. So I already had American music sound from gospel, R&B, hip hop, whatnot. So he's like, you're perfect. Can you write a song for us? And they were like kind of freaking out. After that, I had a chance to meet Hideo, and I sit down in the office and say, hey, I really want you to, write music for us, the Metal Gear Solid. He's like, I really don't know what's gonna happen. Well, this is brand new territory for us. We don't know what's gonna happen. You know, Sony's developing a new PlayStation, you know, game console called PlayStation, and I knew about it, so I was like really, really excited about that. And so that's how everything started out. With the Castlevania was just something like, you know, they told me we really need to have something American song, and so that's when I went to LA and recorded with my friend Jeff Lober and Tony Haynes. He's like a multi. I think he sold about 100 million copies worldwide. He has written everybody. You name it, from Bobby Brown to Boyz II Men to Earth and the Fire. I mean, list goes on. He's got about hundreds of platinum and gold discs. So that's, you know, my first song I wrote for Konami. That's how my career started out with the Konami. So I was kind of like acting as like a more, not just a composer. I was kind of like more like consultant for them, and they would ask me, you know, we sit down and talk, and you know, we would just kind of like try to figure out what would fit for the, you know, music for the video game for the future. Then he there had an idea, you know, want to have a, you know, I don't know, you know, I suggested, what about the Hollywood, you know, film composer? So that's how I, you know, we got Harry, and he asked me, can I get Harry? First, he wanted to get Hans Zimmer, Media Venture, getting involved, and he got denied, so he came to me again, and you think you could get Harry Gregson Williams? And I said, okay, let me call them, let me go and meet with them in LA. So that's how I, you know, brought Harry into the picture for the Metal Gear. Go ahead and ask me anything. Is this your daughter?
It's actually my son.
I was going to ask, when you were writing the song I Am the Wind for Castlevania, like, what was your actual, like, inspiration, like, in a way? Like, was there anything you were influenced by in order to write it the way you did? Or how was the, how did that go? I don't know.
You know, people always ask me, did it inspire? I don't really get inspired to write like I used to. Like, when I was a kid, I get inspired to write. Oh, you know, I don't know. It's just like, because I never got to see any of the video. And people think I got to see the video game, you know, actual trailer or something. I never got to see any of the video game, or I never even look at the script. You know what I mean? They would just tell me, can you write the song? And I'll just write different types of music. And they're like, oh, then I'll present to them. They're like, okay, can you write like this? Or can you, you know, I like that song, you know. Basically, the first two video game was I was pretty much kind of like figured out, or maybe this is the kind of thing they'll tell me, this is the game is all about RPG and whatnot. And Castlevania is about the, you know, RPG game. And this is the first trial, you know, period of time for them to really break a new game into the world. So they needed something more pop, or not hip hop, nothing like that. It's kind of like a middle, down the middle. So I kind of had to figure out what's going to fit in a video game, not just a video game, just for the market. So that's kind of how I write music for the particular, because it's kind of like a commercial writing. But, you know, for Hideo, it's more like, it's not even like, it's like mind reading, you know, for him. It's like I had to read his mind, what he wants, and he would just give me a crazy task, like, can you write something other than English? And I don't want to know about the language. I cannot detect the language. So he wants me to write something. Like, that's how I wrote The Best Is Yet to Come, because he didn't want to use French. He didn't want to use Spanish. He didn't want to use, you know, German. He didn't want to use, you know, Portuguese. You know, he had the whole list of the language he knew that he didn't want to use. So I'm like, okay, can you write something that I can't recognize the language? So I said, how about Gaelic? That's how I wrote the Best Is Yet to Come. And that was the theme song, opening theme song for the Metal Gear Solid, the first one.
Right.
So it's kind of like a different than other type of job that I've done in the past. You know, then he'd be able to tell me, like, can you write the action 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Okay, what kind of action? He's like, I don't know yet. Just write me an action, five different patterns, you know what I mean? So, and then he would tell me five different sneaky section, five different types of ambient, you know. I was like, okay. Like I said, in 20 years, I have never seen anything, the script, nothing. Maybe the last one I worked on in Metal Gear Solid 4, he kind of let us see. I think he made just like a, I don't know, 60-second, 90-second little trailer of that scene. That's it. Only one scene. That's it. I never saw anything. Never.
Wow.
So I would have to read his mind. It's like he would tell me, like, this is the scene. Maybe, you know, some, you know, this big thing's going to be following, you know, and the snake is trying to run away or something, and he's hiding this and that, you know. And he's just kind of like vaguely, but he changed his mind. So it doesn't matter how he's going to tell me, because he's going to change after he, you know, we submit the music. He's going to change his mind. And, oh, by the way, I got inspired to write, you know, because of the music, I got inspired to do this way. You know, that's how he will, you know, kind of change his story also, by listening to the music. So he's not more, he kind of like, he liked the music, and he liked to have music kind of like a fit into what he's thinking. So he will write and create every day. So it's a, you know, it's a different process than the other video game company, I'm sure, you know, that I talked to, you know, mm-hmm. or any director. He's very unique in that way, and he's very more a spontaneous guy, and he has a lot of ideas in his head, and he changed his mind constantly. So, you know, it doesn't matter, you know, we come up with the different types of scene, the tracks, different types of music, and you know, sometimes, like, I end up writing every day for a year, and he rejected me. You know, every day I would write different types of music, and he rejected. You know, he's a very hard person to please, you know.
Wow.
A lot of people probably don't want to work with him because he's very hard and meticulous. He really doesn't know, you know, what to expect until he, you know, you submit it to him. Then he's like, oh, I changed my mind. Oh, I don't like this one. Can you write this again? And he go back to the first one anyway, you know, after you've done about 10 of them.
So how many times did you, when you wrote The Best Is Yet to Come, like, how many different times did you have to write a song?
Oh, the first one, he had no idea. He was actually pleased to get me because I was already a major artist, you know, recording artist at the time.
Okay.
And nobody wanted to work at that time. The video game was, like I said, 20 years ago, video game was in the industry that people wanted to work.
Right.
You know what I mean? People wanted to work for it. And, oh, I'm writing for a video game. People laugh at you. Okay, that was 20 years ago. So I had an advantage, like, okay, I want to write this song this way. And I just told him, hey, look, I'm a musician. This is what I do for professional, you know what I mean? This is what I do for a living. So trust me, if you want Gaelic. So I went into his office. I got 100 CDs, let, you know, him and his, you know, his producer listen to the music, Gaelic, Irish, traditional Irish music. So I told him, this is the kind of music I want to write. I'm thinking like a Gaelic and Gregorian chant, and kind of like a, you know, combine and come up with a very, like, a calm and, I don't know, mysterious, and, you know, have some emotion in it. And, you know, because I, like I said, I never saw the video game, what's going to happen. I just saw Snake, the character of the Snake, and, you know, I never saw anything. So I have no idea, but how he kind of like described it to me, I thought it was kind of like kind of cool to write Gregorian chant and in the Gaelic, you know, kind of Irish traditional music combined with that. So I told him, I'm just gonna give me a budget. I'm just gonna go island and record and come back with it. So he trusted me on, okay, you know, since you're the composer, I trust you 100%, and just come back with the music. And when, you know, he was surprised, you know, to hear that music, and he had that, my music, and iPod every day listening to it. He loved it.
Huh.
You know, that was the first one.
Right.
And the second one was, you know, the the New York. He's like, yeah, this year is gonna be New York. Okay, can you write something kind of fits with the image of New York? That's how he, you know, gave me order. So it's not like, you know, he is so meticulous about a lot of things. No, he's not. He's just so vague, and he doesn't know what he wants until he hears it.
Right.
You know, so I kind of had to read his mind. So I go, okay, New York. Okay, gotta be jazz then. So, you know, then he's like, oh, can we, you know, do the audition? I'm like, okay. So we went to New York and we auditioned in New York. And we picked Carla. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, that was a good time. You know, we all went like 10 days, 10 people came from Konami. We all went everywhere. I took them, since I know New York a lot, I used to do a lot of recording there. So every day I would take them out to everywhere and they had a blast. We had so much fun, you know. So, you know, every time, you know, we do something, it's kind of get like, you know, then there's a company, you know, the industry kind of got blew up all of a sudden, like after Metal Gear Solid 2, the 3 and 4 was insane. And 5, of course, took about 7 years ready to come out soon. But, you know, and structure changed, Konami changed, Hideo changed, you know, everybody changed, and except me. You know, so yeah, it's a different, you know, different era now, you know, because now the video game industry is bigger than the film industry. They're making more, yeah, you know, more revenue than the film industry. So, you know, so now they have a different, you know, different attitude towards a composer now. So, you know, we're the big boy now, you know what I mean? So I'm just like, okay, now before, like, you used to listen to me, so now they don't.
Yeah. And I do think the reason that the video game industry got so big was because of a lot of the stuff that the Metal Gear series did with Metal Gear Solid, and a lot of that also stems from your work, too, so, yeah.
I think the video game, you know, I predicted from the get-go. I told Hideo, you know, right now nobody know what video game. They're only thinking like, you know, all the recording industry thought was just like they weren't even threat to the record company. They weren't even threat to the industry in Hollywood. And I told them just a few years, you know, after this Metal Gear is going to hit, what's going to happen, like Disney, Hollywood, all the studios are going to discover, oh, wow, you know what I mean? This could be an opportunity for film industry. This could be an opportunity for recording industry to advertise their artists, up-and-coming new artists. So what's Activision and other companies doing, Grand Theft Auto, you have a new, you know, release music. They actually, a record company had to pay to put their music, their artists into the video game. Before it was, you know, the other side, you know, like a video game company had to pay to the record company to get their music into their platform. But now, record company had to pay because they consider that as like a product placement or a way to, you know, advertise their new artists, like a radio or TV or internet, you know. So now the video game company can't demand, oh, we need to get paid to put your music in our video game. It's totally different, you know, situation now. Before, video game wasn't really big and nobody really cared about it. You know, they thought the music was just like a real simple beep, 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 you know what I mean? The Mario type of thing, you know? Yeah. But now it's like a video game music is more far complex than ever. And I think we have a great composers working in video game industry, the music-wise. People really, you know, kind of like not, maybe they start to caught up. I think that because I think I was the first one to bring the film composer Harry Gregson Williams into the Metal Gear, and now everybody start to follow that lead because such a successful video game. I think a lot of, you know, video game decide to start to hire the composer from the film industry, and that trend changed, you know, and the. So that took, you know, probably like 10 years that people start to discover, oh, wow, you know, the video game music is really, really good. You know, before people were skeptical about the video game composer, especially recording industry. But now the standard of the video game music composer is so high, and it's probably equivalent or even better than the film industry, you know? In my opinion, I think the video game composer had to do more because it's more a lot to it than the film, because film, you have the scene that you could actually, you know, watch and compose with it. Video game composer, you don't have that luxury. You kind of have to guess and kind of have to feel, okay, this might be this, and you kind of have to go intuitive and intuition with your gut feeling, you know, with okay, I could write different types of music, and maybe that's just how Hideo is, but for me, I had to kind of read his mind and be more, you know, have to, I don't know, it's just like I really have to create something that they haven't heard before, you know.
Yeah, that's
a challenge, you know, it was a challenge for me, because, you know, he did have this really crazy, you know, he liked the crazy music that nobody even heard before, you know, he's more into like, he likes to find somebody that nobody knows, you know what I mean, unknown, unsigned artist. That's why he probably wanted to hire me, because, you know, for him, he's like, I was with a major record company at the same time. I wasn't really major in TV world in Japan. So maybe he thought that was kind of, well, plus I spoke English and I understand the culture here in America. So, you know, it was just a good timing for both of us, you know?
Yeah.
Daily?
Hi, Rika, is that how you pronounce it?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Daly. I came into the call late. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. My first question for you is, you spoke a lot about your work over the titles. My question to you is, working from Metal Gear Solid 1 to 4, how much more difficult was it progressing from game to game, since each game has its own unique theme to it and the time zones are really different? Between the games, one jumps into the late 2000s, one's set in the 60s, the other two are set in the 90s and the early 2000s. Was it difficult for you going from game to game to figure out what kind of music you were going to produce for that era of the game?
Not really. Like I said, I never got to see any of it, so it's the same process. I just had to guess, you know. It's like a video game.
Right.
And the product is a different era, but I never really played the game, so I don't know. I just have a Hideo actually burn me a CD or, you know, at that time VHS video, so I could see what happened with my music. Oh, that's how you use it? Oh, that's how you did it, you know? And so it was too difficult for me to play, you know? And I was just like, I'm stuck at the elevator. I can't go down there. You know, what do I do? You know, so
as a right,
I'm just stuck there. What am I supposed to do with it? You know?
Yeah, so. I can see that. But the main point of the question is, when you're doing a game like Metal Gear Solid 3, it's got a much different tone than some of the other stuff that you have done. And the same thing with 4. When you're picking out like which kind of equipment you're going to use, whether you're going to use guitars or pianos or this kind of stuff, did you have any trouble picking it from game to game to kind of make that the music that you wanted to make based off what you were told?
Not really. I mean, music is, you know, I mean, I just give him whatever is different. And maybe he liked this, you know what I mean? That's the kind of guessing game for me every time. You know, for me, working with Hideo is totally different than working with the other director. So I kind of had to give them something that he haven't heard, or maybe he might like this, you know. And he was just giving me like, oh, just write me a sad song, or, you know, I want a really hard action. You know, he would give me a fast tempo. I want a fast tempo. That, you know, then he would give me like a fast tempo. Maybe he goes down to a little bit slower. So I break it down. We usually have a 2 minutes for the cue. And 30 second. I divide it into four. Then the climax at the end. And I'll just give them a loop where they can loop. So what I would do is I'll put it in the files, the different files, where they could kind of cut and, and paste and
that's very smart.
Wherever, you know, wherever they want to cut and they want to make it longer, they could do that. Then so I have a, like a files after files. So it's not just a composing music. I have to sit there and organize 250 to 300 stems audio files. And because I have like a 5.1 surround system, so I end up having like 300 tracks of the audio file that I had to organize and make it, you know, look like something like they could organize later too. So it's more of like an organization than anything.
Okay.
And working with them. Yeah. It's totally different than composing for other genre of, you know, record company or artist or film or commercial, you know, anything. It's just working with, I think working with Hideo was just like a totally different than other video game kind of work, I gather, you know, by talking to other composers. So it was just like an unknown in the world, you know, it's like an open world forever, you know.
I mean,
you got open question, million questions that you can't answer or you can't even ask him because he really doesn't know either, you know, until you deliver. So it's like, okay, until he doesn't know. So until you deliver the music, and then he was like, oh, okay. And then he would give me another hint. Then you have to write again. Then he'd give me another hint. Then this goes on and on. Then he's like, well, he goes back to the first one. So I think I like the first one. Okay. Hmm. You know, that's just how it goes.
Oh.
So, yeah, it's totally different than working with other composers. I mean, other director, I think.
Oh, yeah, that's very interesting. I was just thinking about this too, because you said that you never got to see any of the stuff while you were working on it. Did you think that, wait, with the exception of 4, which you said you only got like a 90-second trailer thing.
Right.
Do you think that if you had seen the actual the footage and stuff that they were working on, do you think the music would have turned out differently than what you had actually composed?
I think it would have matched vividly, precisely, because Harry is a film composer. I think he would be able to write better music for the cue, because, you know, that's what Harry's used to. And before, you know, I give him a direction what to write, how to write, whatever. Depending by talking to Hideo and his producer, and they will give me the idea. Then I had to kind of translate that into music, and then I put my, you know, idea into that. Then I'll tell Harry, this is the kind of cue that I want that he gives me. Then I'll tell him, no, I want it this way or that way. Then, you know, we kind of, you know, make it. But even though I think, because I guess I didn't see it, I think it was more freedom, free, so we could create better music, I think. Because I think what happened is you kind of get locked in. If you see the scene, you kind of had to locked in. Oh, I had to cut here, and I had to, you know, do the transition at 32 seconds instead of 30, you know, I mean, 25 seconds. Then you only have it 3 seconds. Then you kind of had to be locked in watching it, you know, instead of just kind of creating the music and let Hideo and other, you know, at the end of the day, they could cut and paste if they wanted to make it longer of a 30-second version of the loop or whatever. So I always kind of give them room so they could kind of play with it, you know. So I think it was more like an organic way of making it. I think that's probably why he didn't want us to see it, because he kind of wanted to rely on our creativity to give them something challenge. He liked the challenge, so I think that was more like a battle for him. You know, it's always a battle for, you know, it's like a, it's always like kind of like fighting, you know, me. We give him, you know, something better, then he comes up with a better idea, then we give him something better. It's kind of like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. But it was more creative, like a battle between us than him. You know, with him. So it was kind of cool. And but at 3 or 4, at the 4, you know, he got so busy with being, you know, executive at the Konami, and you know, his job was more demanding, and his team got 300 people instead of 20 people. How we started out was only 20 people. It was more relaxed, and the company is more relaxed. And after they went on an IPO public, and, you know, you have a different opinions from a executive board and board members and the stock, you know, holder. It became a corporate. So it wasn't very creative environment anymore. You know what I mean? So that's why I think that a lot of creativity suffered, and I think that's probably why Hideo got let go, because his business sense is, you know, isn't there. He's a creator, and he doesn't think about the money or budget, anything like that. So he'll continue to keep making, you know, game, you know, how he feels like making. Oh, he feels like this is complete. When he's not complete, he keep going, you know. And that's just how he is. And that company can't afford to have a, you know, employee like that. They need to be budget. They need to have a deadline. They need to have a recouping point, you know. And Hideo doesn't think like that.
So you
just want to create, you know, yeah, whatever he feels like creating.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So you're saying because of his, you know, vision, because of his, because of what he wants to do, it made him less of a less valuable business person, because he's not the one to cut and dry deadline, you know, same game every time.
No. He, you know, as you know, as of, you know, waiting for fans to, you know, how long, you know what I mean? He always have a projection date. Of course he's going to have we're going to release it. But that release date comes like, oh, we're going to delay. How long? He doesn't know. You know what I mean? Something happened. And, you know, he wanted to create the new engine. That took longer than he expected. And, you know, it's something like that Fox engine. He didn't think he's going to take a long time, but he did. So that kind of pushed it back later. And a lot of things, you know, he didn't anticipate. There's a lot of things in the business he didn't anticipate, you know. So, you know, it's just like he's a creator. And I think he's a really, really good creator, you know, one of the best. And he is, but he's not a really good businessman, you know. And when you have a big company like that, you have an employee with more than 6,000. You gotta have a business sense. How can I recoup that money? You know, if you put down $200 million, you gotta recoup. At least, you know, you gotta be able to have a recouping point, you know, somehow.
You have to have profit.
You gotta have a profit. He doesn't think about profit. You know, he think that, you know, if it's a product is good, somebody's gonna buy it. You know, yeah, right. Back in the day, yeah, you only had 20 employees working with you, but now you got 300 employees, staff. You know, you gotta cover the expenses.
So it's,
and, you know, he didn't think like that. You know.
So I guess it seems like with Hideo, for him, it was more about the passion and the art rather than making money.
He didn't care about the money because he was getting paid, you know, whatever the money he's getting paid for 20 years, the same, you know?
Right. He already knew he was getting paid.
No, he didn't care. It was a delay. He's not going to suffer. He's not getting like you're making like $2 million. You're going to go down to $100,000. No, it's not like that. So whatever he made in the 20 years ago, he told me that's how much he's making. I don't know if that's true or not, but, you know, he didn't. You know, he doesn't live in like a fancy Hollywood, you know, luxury lifestyle, you know.
Right.
He's a salaryman. In Japan, salaryman, which is, you get monthly payment, you know, every month. And they don't even have a bonus. And Konami believes in no bonus. So they kind of give a little bit more than the regular company. And they break it down to 12 times. So whatever the money, you know, it's the same. He doesn't get more because the Metal Gear Solid made more money. No, he doesn't get that either. Before, they used to have a profit share, but they don't even have profit share anymore. So whatever the money, you know, the video game, the Metal Gear or whatever that he produced made, he doesn't even get that. So it's a different type of salary than the American video game company, I think.
Wow. So
the American company, different.
So he gets what he gets, and that's it.
That's it.
Wow.
He doesn't get anything. Yeah. So that's why, you know, for him, it's like, that's why I'm just going to keep doing what I'm doing, and I'm not making more or less, you know? So whatever the money he's making the same amount of money. So, you know, for him, it's like, it's the same.
Now, did that work the same for you too?
Well, my budget got increased, let me tell you that. For me, because the first one, they had no idea how much, you know, music gonna, I mean, how much video game is gonna sell. For me, I actually put my own money they didn't have enough money for me to go island at that time. And I had a 5 different projects going on at the same time with the record company and other artists I was working on overseas. So I said, don't worry about it. I'll just put my own money. If I don't have enough money, I'll put my own money. And that's, you know, that's what I did. Because I truly believe in it, you know.
Go ahead, Gabe.
Actually, I don't know. Can you take the next question, Mike?
Sure. I think this song kind of got overlooked a little bit in Metal Gear Solid 3. Don't Be Afraid. I think it was featured in the scene, a love scene with Snake right. and the female protagonist, Eva.
Right.
How did that one come about? I mean, you say that you didn't see, you know, you hardly really saw the games. So
I actually saw the footage because, like I said, every time somebody, I put my music, they always give me CD-ROM. This is how we use. And now I could go on YouTube and I could see it. So I actually see how they use my music. But what happened with originally, that Don't Be Afraid was going to become, I think, theme song or something. And then because the budget, what happened is the employee, he was like, do me a favor, can you help my employee to write music? That was Hibino.
Oh, yeah.
And I had the, what happened is like, you know, Hideo begged me to share my budget with his employee, Hibino, and help him to write the music. That was Snake Eater. I basically arranged all his music and made it much better than what he had. And I hired a singer, then I made it into a totally different song, which that was a Snake Eater. So I was supposed to be writing the music for a theme song. Then, you know, Hibino had an idea. He wanted to write, I guess he's an employee at the Konami at that time. So Hideo begged me to, you know, share my budget and can you have him write the theme song? Then can you write, you know, he knew, you know, Hibino wasn't cut out to be able to do it. So he asked me, can you write, you know, can you help arrange the music and, you know, share your budget? So I had the full budget, then my budget got cut down, so I had to write music something simple and something cheaper. And all my budget went into Hibino's music instead of me. So I had to kind of make my music a lot simpler than his, and just kind of, you know, that's why I ended up writing music for jazz, and I could get the jazz musician and the string orchestra, and, you know, it's like one take, you know, for me, you know, so
you that's put, what happened. You put all of the pieces together for the song Snake Eater?
Yeah, I did all the programming, arrangements, and everything. Basically, whatever you hear the music for Metal Gear Solid 1, 2, 3, 4, I produce all of it. I get the budget. I get more than composer job. People don't realize that. I get production, you know, budget. So I'm the one putting out, you know, put the budget together. I put the, you know, I hired an engineer, hired the musician to orchestra, singers, to whoever that you hear on the music.
Very, very, very cool.
That's very interesting. Like, I mean, you when you play the games, I mean, you watch the intros and it shows the who did the music and everything like that. Like for Metal Gear Solid 2, 3, 4 as well, I think. And I think he's even doing music for 5. Harry Gregson-Williams. It says it credits him as the composer. Why don't they put your name in the credits as well? I mean, that's almost like a slap in the face.
Yeah, I took that abuse.
Yeah,
Yeah, 20 years, and I'm the one brought Harry Gregson Williams into this picture. Then, you know, at the end of, because, you know, in Hideo's mind, he is a, you know, composer from Hollywood. You know, in Japanese people, they only look at the credit, and I'm the, you know, resource behind and idea and everything. But, you know, I think the music, you probably will hear the difference between all the music from Metal Gear 1, 2, 3, 4, and the 5. So I'm kind of curious to hear what the fans gonna say, because I think the music is suffer tremendously because I'm not there. But they gotta, you know, because the budget, they had to cut me. They say I'm too expensive.
A lot of people actually want to know that, and I think we kind of already know the answer. Is your music featured in the Phantom Pain?
Excuse me?
I said, is your music featured in the Phantom Pain?
Is my music featured in Metal Gear Solid 5? No.
Right. Mm-mm. Okay. All right.
No. No, I was involved with in the beginning, and you know, Hideo had an issue. You know, basically what they wanted to do is they wanted to cut down the budget. So they had to let go of me, and then they wanted to ask. I told them they could go ahead and, you know, work with Hideo, Harry, and Hideo's, not Hideo, the Harry's, you know, the guy that actually was writing for Harry. He, you know, Harry was too busy, so we actually had the other guy, Ghostwriter, writing for the music for Metal Gear. I hate to disappoint you, but Harry wasn't writing all the music. And that's just goes in Hollywood. Harry, Grayson Williams, other composers have about hundreds of, you know, a composer behind writing, working for them, you know.
Yeah, it definitely, like I said, I mean, I'm not trying to discredit any of the other musicians who did the music for the games. I just felt like, and no offense, writers of Metal Gear, but I feel like they got too much credit. Especially when you were behind quite a bit of it.
Yeah, but it's okay. You know, I'm going to start doing my own thing, so they're going to start seeing that. Because, you know, finally, because actually I'm really happy Hideo left, whatever the reason, and I'm really happy he will be able to do what he wants to do, maybe, with that Konami. And I hope, you know, I told him to get out of the company about more than 10 years ago, you know, get the hedge fund money and start your own company, but he didn't think like that because he's more Japanese, and I think like that because I grew up half of my life here in America, so I don't really think like a Japanese people. So he
really just kind of wanted to take the traditional route.
Yeah, well, like I said, his money hasn't changed for 20 years. So he's happy just getting this monthly salary, you know what I mean?
Right.
He's just happy getting the stable income every month and be able to create. So that's, to me, it's not a creator. That's, to me, is just you working for 9 to 5. You know, I'm a freelance, so even though I don't have a job for God knows how long, I'm okay because that's all I chose. You know, if I was a musician, that's just, you know, I need to find the next gig, and that's how my mentality is. Like, I'm a freelance forever because I'm a musician. I'm a jazz musician from the heart, you know. So I'm like a, you know, I mean, one of those struggle artists all the way, you know what I mean?
Right.
Till I die. I think I want to have that, you know, hungriness in my, because if I start making a lot of money, then I'm not creative, you know?
Right.
But, you know, I have made a lot of money for other people will think, yes, I have, and thank God for that. But still, you know, I'm still the same, you know, I'm still trying to get a gig next, you know, event, next, you know, club or whatever, next production, you know, I'm still the same, you know, I'm still doing the same things ever since I started out when I was 16 years old. I've been doing this for a long time, and I've been doing this same thing over and over again. I put the budget together, I put the musician, I've been doing it since I was 16 years old. I was band leader. This funny thing that happened is, like, when I was 16, I got hired to do a gig in a club, and they're all like a, you know, legend, like, you know, in that field, a jazz musician. They were a lot older than me. They were like 60, 70 years old. I was only 16, 17 at that time. And they realized I had a talent to be a band leader. And not only that, I had a talent to be a real good negotiator to the club owner or the event, you know, organizer or something. So they all like, Rika, you got skills. Like, what do you mean I got skills? No, you know how to talk to these people. So you know what? You should negotiate with all, you know, jobs that we have coming up. So that's how I became band leader at the age 17, 18. So I was a kid. I didn't know, and they would tell me what to ask. So I'll just go and ask, and I got everything I needed or more. So they're like, you, that's a talent. You know, most musicians can't do that.
Right.
So I didn't know, you know, that was talent or not, but they just told me a lot about the music business, and I'm so thankful that they taught me about copyrights, publishing, and having to license your music, and that's going to be the asset instead of just being a player. So I knew about writing music is a, you know, it's going to be a commodity, it's going to be my asset for the rest of my life. So they taught me that when I was 16, 17 years old. So I was like, you know, ahead of the time, you know?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right, John, you want to take the next question?
Yeah. I'm a little lost. I just got here. Can somebody run me up to speed real quick?
Go ahead, Gabe.
Okay.
Me?
Yes.
So you want me to take the question?
Yeah, you go ahead and take the question. I'll,
I'm sorry. I still can't get used to all these interviews and stuff. I'm always really nervous when I'm doing them.
No, why? Why are you nervous?
I don't know. It's just something I've always, you know, we've done like two of these now, and it's just like I'm always really like.
I'm
waiting. John, well, you know, talk to me like you're talking to your mom. I'd probably be like older than me, like your mom. Anyway, hey mom, you know, what's it for dinner tonight? You know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
All right. I guess I'll take
it.
All right. I guess. So we know you're doing some like work with the orchestra now. Is that correct? If you could tell us about that, that'd be great.
Tell about the orchestra, what?
Oh, something.
You told me a couple weeks ago that you were going to be traveling with an orchestra.
Oh yeah. I am actually going to be doing a concert with Akira. Maybe his schedule is good. I'm going to be doing a concert with Akira in Mexicali. November this year. Then next year I'll be traveling. I think I'm going to be part of Video Game Live. I'm not sure. Dubai want me to come and perform with the orchestra. I think Spain and Italy and Brazil. So, and other, you know, places that Comic-Con overseas actually want me to come and perform the music I've done for the past 20 years. So, you know, I'm kind of excited about that. And this year, you know, a lot of these Comic-Con, they really don't have the budget. So, you know, what I'm doing is I'm just going to go and, you know, meet fans, because it's always interesting to see fans and hear what they think about the music. And they actually inspire me to, you know, continue to do what I'm doing. So, I'm starting to go to Comic-Con, like starting 6th of August. I'm going to Utah, Salt Lake, Utah. I'm going to Florida, Orlando. Then I'm going to Arizona, Virginia, Dubai, Brazil, Italy, and I'm going everywhere this year.
Do you know when you'll be going to Florida? Comic-Con?
I'm going on the, I think 15, 16, I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm on the Orlando, Florida.
Orlando?
Yeah.
Okay.
Why?
I'll have to make my way there. I'm in Florida myself.
Oh, good. So you need to come in. I haven't really got back to the organizer because they said they really don't have the money to fly me. But I say, well, maybe I want to go because I want to, you know, I want the support. So I might just go there, just to go there. And I don't care about the money. So I'm just going to say, oh, I might just go out there, you know.
Definitely. I know I'll be there for that. So.
Because I think a lot of fans, if you could plug in the Florida, they have people come. Because I made this cool T-shirts, which I'm going to send you all, you guys. So send me all the address. I haven't had a chance to go to FedEx yet, so I'm sorry. Give me all your guys' size. I'm going to send you guys my did you see the black T-shirts with the red explanation mark?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, so nice. I did.
You like that?
That's awesome.
Yeah,
wait,
so
are you
I'm actually, you know,
yes,
whoever comes to the Comic-Con, they're going to get free T-shirts, you know, instead of just autograph. I'm going to give away the autograph and the T-shirts. That's a pretty good deal, right?
It is.
Very good deal for the fans.
Right, for the fans, right? So I'm like, you know what? Fans going to pay, like, how much to just get an autograph? I thought that was ridiculous myself. And, you know, a lot of fans, they really don't have any money. And I had this one guy came to Comic-Con 2 weeks ago, and that was my first Comic-Con that I did in the United States. And this guy would come, show up every day for 3 days. He would just sit and talk to me every single day. Okay, he won't buy anything because he's, you know, I knew he didn't have the money. So by the end of the day, the third day, I just ended up giving him a T-shirt. Here, here's a T-shirt's autograph, and he was happy. So I think I did that for a couple guys. You know, I mean, kids, you know, they're just having a hard time just paying to get in, you know. I feel bad, you know, because, you know, they're just kids. I'm sure their allowance isn't that much. You know, they have to ask their mom or, you know, whoever. And some of the kids, they don't even look like they have money. So, you know, I felt bad. Then, you know, the kid's like, well, can you write here an autograph? And because I signed autograph in his brochure, and my guys look at me, it's like, oh, we still have to charge you. And he's like, I only have $4. I'm like, what? And everybody's like, you autograph already. You can't charge them. And I'm like, no, I'm like, forget it. I don't need $4. Just keep it, you know. I mean, it's just some of the kids, they really don't have the money, but they really want to get an autograph and talk to me. So, you know, I understand. You know, that's how probably I was when I was a kid, you know.
Yeah.
So. Really, I just want to kind of, to, you know, get back to the people, get back to the kids, you know, they said they listened to my music. I just wanted to talk to them, what kind of, you know, and a lot. I was, like, really, really fascinated. They all knew my music. I didn't know anybody listened to my music, you know, so I was like, oh, okay, I got a lot of people listening to my music. So that's kind of a good feeling, you know?
Definitely.
I think that's pretty amazing that, you know, you're not just like somebody who's gonna go and say, oh, it's like, oh, this is how it is, you know, like that, you know, and like, you know, basically if somebody has some sort of issue or something, you're not just gonna be like, you know, kick them like while they're down or anything. That's awesome.
Yeah, because, you know, they're people, and I'm, you know, I'm not really, you know, I'm not really like snob like other people think, you know. I'm just like down to earth, you know. I'm probably more real than anybody, you know. I understand not having money, I understand not having money. I'm, you know, the both worlds, so I understand, you know. So I just relate to people, you know.
Absolutely. Before we move on from the Metal Gear questions, I know that's pretty much what we've been talking about the whole time. And okay. Number one, I apologize for that. Very last question. Okay. It's a fan question. Pretty sure it may come from all of us, and I've already asked you, and you've told me when we were talking on Twitter. But were you to pick a song from any of the games that you've composed for, which one would be your favorite and why?
The Best Is Yet to Come, I think. That was the first one I worked with Hideo, like I told you.
Right.
He gave me this question, like, can you write a song that I don't want to know and recognize the language? You know, that was his question. Can you write some song other than French, Spanish, Germans, and, you know, he had the list, whole list. So that's whole language, you know. So I had to kind of go left curve, and I said, how about Gaelic? He's like, Gaelic? What the hell's Gaelic? So I got him on that, you know.
There's something I've always wondered about this song is, where did the title, The Best Is Yet to come from?
The best is yet to come. At the good things in life were still yet to come. And
okay.
You should appreciate the simple thing in life. You know, people kind of forget. You know, walking, you know, down the street with your dog. That's, to me, that's, you know, most enjoyment, like a joyful moment in my life right now. Every day, you know, just be able to walk with my dog. You know, and she's so happy just going out there, walking with me, and she is my best trainer, and she's looking at me like she wants to go out soon, so
we won't keep you too much longer. One song we haven't touched on, and I'm ashamed of myself because I'm a huge fan of this series as well. Let's talk about the ending theme for Silent Hill.
Okay, I read that in Argentina.
Really?
Buenos Aires.
Is that where the title comes from?
Esperodonte. Waiting. It's waiting. Is I got the title because of the kind of when Akira explained to me what the game is. Again, I have never seen the game. He says it's kind of like a real scary game, just like Biohazards or you know Resident Evil type of thing. And you know, he and I talk, and it's like okay. Then he has to be kind of spooky. Then again, they want something different. So I said, how about Tango? And then I told Akira, it's almost like I had a fight with Akira, but I'm really good friend with him. But like, I'm like, Akira, just listen, you know, you just, you working here 9 to 5, you know, because you can get a record deal. Dude, seriously, let me just go and do what I do. Then I think you'd be happy. Just, you know, again, that didn't have the budget either. Hold, this is in the beginning. So I said, don't worry about it. I got 5 projects going. I'm just going to go Argentina record. And that's what happened. And I came back with the music. I don't know if it's like a, you know, is it good or bad? I don't know. Some people like it, some people don't, because it probably don't fit into that whole video game. It's so odd, maybe. You know, people don't know anything about Tango. But I was fortunate to be able to record with one of the original member of Piazzolla, the guy, you know, guy's a legend. And you know, he's probably the only guy who really made it internationally as a band, you know, and the composer. That's, you know, I was influenced by that guy. So I'm like, well, I think we should record it in Argentina. So I went.
Now, when you say Akira, are you talking about the composer for the Silent Hill games?
Yeah, he was also the producer at the time.
Right, yeah, absolutely. Okay.
So, you know, I had to talk to him. That's why I'm going to be having a concert with him, Silent Hill, Mexicali,
okay,
with him this year in November. So, you know, Astor Piazzolla is one of the best Argentina tango composer, banyan player and arranger, and he has changed the way of looking at the banyan of the tango music into another level of art form. And you know, so I was so much fond of his music, and I wanted to do something different. I thought, okay, you know, and Akira told me this is about, you know, waiting to see who's gonna come, the next, you know, object, the next spooky, I don't know, whatever, the, you know, the nurse or whatever, the, you know, I don't know. They have all kinds of people coming in, and it's like they're always hiding at the Silent Hill game. So he says that somebody's waiting for you, watching you. So that's kind of my lyrics was that somebody's always watching and waiting for you at the corner or whatever. So I kind of wrote the song like that in the Spanish.
I love it. I that's one of my favorites. So.
Oh, okay.
Good job on that one.
Not many people, I don't know, actually knew that song was exist because I think they all had the happy ending instead of bad ending.
Yeah. Well. Yeah. Right.
So if you don't play the bad ending, you don't know my song.
Exactly.
If you went and played bad ending all the time, you heard my music a lot of time. But if you didn't, you know, if you had a good ending, then you don't have to listen to my music. You didn't have to listen to my music.
Well, I prefer the bad ending music.
Thank you.
Okay, anyway, sorry, before we continue, I just wanted to ask if Daly or John had anything, because, you know, I know they've been...
Absolutely.
Yeah, I've got something. John, do you got something you want to go for? You haven't asked anything yet, man.
Well, I'm more... I don't know what we've already asked is the thing.
I would like maybe a quarter way down the page, maybe.
How are you guys gonna publish it in writing, and how are you guys to do this?
What we're doing right now is we are recording the video, we're recording where we're streaming from, and then we're going to upload that to YouTube later.
Yeah,
oh, cool.
We have a channel of the same name. Really, I've lost the question.
Too.
Sorry.
I have my subscribe like a YouTube channel. Maybe you guys could upload that.
Yes, I've seen it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know anybody watching that. I'm trying to make a reality TV show. I'm actually shooting. I'm the one with the camera
cool.
Behind. I know it's crazy. I had this idea, and I actually had a really good camera, you know, camera woman, I'll say. I could really take a good photograph and, you know, record, you know, whatever the object is. So right now, technology is so good. You really don't need to have a skills. All you got to do is push a button. You right. have to have a good ISO and a good focus and a good selfie angle. Stick. And right now, it's like a video camera. We have to have before. You need to have a technique, and you have to know all the aperture, then ISO, then all that frame, you know, speed, shots, and everything. But right now, the camera got computer technology so great.
Oh, yeah.
You don't even have to be, you know, camera shabby or technology shabby to do all that stuff. So I could actually take pretty good, you know, shot. And I showed to a lot of people in the industry. They're like, "You shot this? You shot this? Are you sure?" Like, yeah, the camera does everything, dude. Seriously, you just have a good idea, and you can, anything, you know. So, and I edit too. So it's just, you know, right now I'm shooting, and now I think I got cable network is interesting. Follow me around everywhere I go, and a Comic Con.
Very cool.
Which is, yeah.
So I did have a question for you. It pertains to just your work in general over across all of the games. Is there any song that you, because you talked a little bit earlier about how you would rewrite songs or you would send stuff in that would get denied. Is there a song that you absolutely loved that never made it into a game?
Oh, yeah. So I was thinking, like, I had to go into my storage, but I have like a 20 drives. Each one's about 500 to 1 terabyte. So I was thinking maybe I should just release that, you know, denied by Hideo Kojima.
That's what I was getting at, because I'm sure if you wrote all of this stuff for all of these games,
great
there's got
to
be great stuff.
Yeah, I got great music. He didn't really approve, and I was like, why didn't you pick this one? This is better than, you know, but whatever, it's a political reason. And, you know, at that time, maybe he felt that way in his emotion, because he goes by the emotions, not by the really what sound like. So whatever the time his situation is, you know, he feel like he wanted to deny. That's fine. You know, whatever. So, you know, I have a lot of music, and a lot of fans ask me, can you release those? And I'm sure a lot of fans will probably want to hear that.
Right. I would definitely be one to excited to see some of the stuff that didn't necessarily make it.
Yes.
And just kind of see, you know, what didn't make it could be just as good as what did.
So maybe that's my next CD then. Okay. Wherever I go to Comic Con, maybe that's what I should sell. Because I noticed that people want to buy soundtrack instead of the... I have a lot of video game. You should definitely come out to my Comic Con. Because I have a lot of video game that you can only get in Japan. Like, my parents actually literally stand 5-6 hours in the cold and they got it, and with among with other fans. And they were only allowed two. You know, you can only allowed to buy two at a time. One person can only buy two video game. And my mom and my dad, between both of them, they got like a, you know, limited edition version of that. So I have a lot of things that you can't buy, and you know. My parents is great. They will line up, you know. Oh, this is my daughter's music, and
awesome.
Like whatever. You know, they will tell everybody who's standing there. It's like, Ma, please, you know, because I can go. So my parents was in Japan at that time, and they were still alive, and they will support me in that way. They will go to the video game shop like you would stand with the other kids. You know, they're probably looking at them, why are they here? You know what I mean?
Right.
So that's how I got all the limited edition from, you know, that you can only get in Japan. So I have those. And, you know, I'm trying to get rid of a lot of stuff. My place in Tokyo is getting really, really cluttered. So everybody's like, why don't you get rid of it? You know, so I guess I could. So I'm trying to get rid of a lot of my, you know, I have a whole entire room full of video games. So I brought back a lot of stuff because my parents. So I'm, you know, like a little bit, I thought fam might want to, I could share with them. I thought maybe fam wants to see it and want to, you know, and, you know, a lot of time they'll come and say, oh my God, I can't believe you have this, you know. So I get that a lot, and they'd like to see that. So, yeah. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah, I definitely think the fans would love to see some of that unreleased stuff. I think it would be very, very cool. Then my last question for you before I switch it over is, I was very curious about you're the composer and you put these groups together for the Metal Gear games and such. How do you decide what songs you're going to sing personally and what songs you're going to make personally, and then which ones you're going to give out, like, for instance, like Cynthia Hall or Donna Burke or any of the other singers or composers that are people that make the music in Metal Gear? Do you pick specific, like, elements that you want to do yourself or specific songs, or is it just kind of luck of the draw who gets to do what?
No. I actually, compose music. And now I have a singer in my mind who's going to fit. And so I actually write music for that specific singer.
That makes way more sense.
Then also, I have already know, okay, the Cynthia have a good range. And she has a certain tone. And I know Elisa could, and she's more jazz than the Cynthia. Because Cynthia have done all the jingles, for God knows how long, for maybe 20, 30 years and decades. And she was a commercial queen in Chicago. That's how I met her in Chicago when I was, I was in Chicago. And she did all the advertisement from McDonald's to United Airlines to any, you name it, Budweiser, wherever you hear in the music right now, the commercial singing, that was her. You know what I mean? Oh, and back
very,
in the days.
Very cool.
So she, she's like another, people know her voice, but people really don't know her. Same thing like Luther Vandross. He was a jingle singer before he became a star. A lot of, jingles. Oh. Same thing with the Barry Manilow. And what's his name? Billy Joel. He was a jingle writer. He was writing jingle. Yeah, me too. So he writes commercial because that's why his music is so good. It's whole hook, hookies and like really, it's so calculated. And he just writes a brilliant music and a brilliant song, catchy phrase and commercial writing. He's a superb in the commercial writing. So a lot of, people who, used to be working in commercial advertisement world,
Very cool. Well, thank you for answering that. Guys, that was my last question on these topics. So, Jonathan, you want to take it?
Okay. We understand you're working on a mobile game.
Yeah, I'm still trying to raise some money. I'm doing the drifting. I know original Drift King, Kenichi Tsuchiya, the guy who taught Paul Walker, the Fast and Furious. Drift King was he was the original inventor for drifting, like how to drive and drifting and the shifting gears and all that stuff and putting in neutral. And so I have a drift team in Japan. So I wanted to bring them over here from Japan, and I wanted to create the show, my reality show. I want to bring this one girl. She is a champion, lady champion in Japan, and I want her to teach Snoop Dogg how to drift here in the United States, maybe in Vegas. That's where Snoop lives. So I want to bring her here, and I want to go up to Snoop and say, hey, this girl could drift, or, she could really, really drive, and she could race, so he's probably going to laugh, So that's kind of funny, and I want to make a TV show, and I want to make a video game of drift game. Online and mobile app. It's not a really cool drifting game out there because drifting is about modifying the car. So I want to make the video game and how to modify it and make your own drift car. Then you could race with against all the other car and maybe online interactive, like online with if I'm here in LA, I could actually play with the guys in New York or Africa. And you have your own car, like your own special car that you could only kind of make it, that kind of stuff. And I have a guy in Japan who actually modified drift. the car, regular car, regular Nissan, you know, GTR to drift car. So those things, I think the kids, you know, I think a lot of, you know, drift fan, like drifting, like if people go to the race and stuff, that they're really, really into modifying their car. I think they would love to see how Japanese people modify their car. So I kind of want to, it's not just a drifting game, but it's more like a, you can make your own, you know, own original car.
Very cool. Sounds like Kickstarter's in order.
Right, right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Are you just composing? Are you, what is your part in this game?
I'm gonna make it. I'm gonna raise the money. I actually made two software already about 20 years ago. So, I'm gonna produce it. I'm gonna, you know, I'm definitely gonna hire the studio to do all that. But I'm gonna oversee it. So I'm gonna raise the money and you know, make a drift game.
Should get Hideo to do it.
Nah, no, he can't do it because he doesn't know the drift for. Yeah, this is more like a passion for me than anything. And I'm also making American Idol meets a real world type of, you know, reality TV show. I'm gonna show how to make a star behind the scenes and create hit songs. And I'm gonna show everything on TV, and people can follow me on TV. And I'm gonna make a video game out of that too. It's like a Monopoly game, you know, how do you make a star? Then if you make a bad decision, even if you got a record deal, you end up losing all the money because you made the bad decision, you know, that kind of stuff. And I'm going to make a karaoke game with that online, not online, like with the mobile app. I could have like a karaoke with it, and I'm going to have all the music that you could sing to it, and you have you have a score. Okay, you missed about three different notes here, eight bars. You missed this pitch. You missed this rhythm. And then, you know, I'm gonna have a whole like analyze with the karaoke. You sing, and you get like, oh, you're about 67%. You almost perfect. You know, that kind of stuff. So I have a lot of idea what kind, you know, the kind of the game that I want to make with the TV show. Then also you could experience it shopping too. I'm going to have all kinds of products, placements within the video game and TV that we could click it. You can go and buy online instantly.
Nice.
Yeah, that sounds
real. I need more than Kickstarter. I need money, okay? I need somebody who's got money.
Hey, Kickstarter does pretty good nowadays. I think Bloodstained hit 5 million.
Yeah, I need more than 5 million. I'm talking, looking about $100 million to start the, you know, 360 media company. I'm talking hedge fund, Wall Street people. I'm going for the real money here.
That whole concept sounds really amazing, and I'm a big fan of customization stuff in general. Like I'll spend in a game where you can customize a character, I'll spend like hours doing that.
Right.
And then just adding that to, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Yeah, no, but I know the drift game, that they don't have enough customization though. That's why I know the engineer, the guy who does this for a living, and he's the number one drift driver in Japan. And he's actually a mechanic too. So I'm talking about a real mechanic is showing how to make your car into a drift car. And that's like it. You know what I mean? Anybody wants to watch that. Anybody wants to get hold of that. You know what I mean?
Right.
So more like education type of thing. Like for me, it's like a game and educating kids, educating people. This is how you do it. This is how you drift. And it's more like even the game I'm going to, it's like I'm going to have an original drift king, maybe Kenichi Tsuchiya or somebody show them how to drift in a video game. This is how you drift. You know what I mean? Instead of just you just trying to do it with the, you know, just a PlayStation console, you actually gonna learn how to drift by watching the video game.
Right.
That's
awesome.
Pretty cool, right?
That is pretty cool. It's not, so it's more like a simulator than just an arcade style driving game.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'm kind of like looking at the flight simulator type of thing. Plus, like, you gotta feel it that you're really drifting, and you're gonna, you know, race with the other guy. But you get to really feel the drifting though for yourself. If I have money, I want to do the vibration and body sonic and vibrate the whole entire, you know, sound, trick it out the sound, you know, with the arcade thing. And that's what I really want to do. Maybe that'd I need to, cool. You know, that maybe I need to sell that idea to somebody. I don't know.
One thing I haven't caught, what is the title of this game?
I haven't really thought about it. I have, if you go to my channel, it's called Hollywood Dream. It's going to be Hollywood Dream Drift Team. So it's going to be Hollywood Dream Drifting Game, I guess. I'm gonna, within the Hollywood Dream TV show, I'm going to have a different online game app and all that stuff.
Right.
So, you know, you could enjoy watching TV or you could go online and, you know, you could play a game at the same time.
All right.
Well,
it hasn't be done before.
If this does get released, will it be available on Android and what do you call it?
iOS.
iOS, yes.
Yeah, definitely.
Good.
Yeah.
Good.
All right.
I think I'm not going to make the same mistake Konami made. I'm not trying to spend a couple hundred million dollars making AAA video game and not be able to, you know, recoup it. So I'm doing like a real, like, you know, I'm like, you know, I'm more into budget, you know what I mean? I'm not trying to go over budget, you know, I'm trying to make a video game really, really low cost. And, you know, that's why I'm putting together with the TV, YouTube, and, you know, just whatever the digital technology, the format, media, social media, everything's available right now. So it's a different time, a different era, so I could promote my video game and TV in a different way.
Yeah.
All right. You want to take that Comic-Con question, Mike?
Yeah. So as you've already told us, you were recently in Comic-Con over at Connecticut. I actually bugged the hell out of you while you were at Comic-Con in Connecticut. let's see. You're continuing to do the events. How's the experience and interactions with the fans actually been? I mean, has it been enjoyable, or does it sometimes seem more like a chore?
No, I really enjoy talking to these people because, like I said, this is my first time. And I was really fascinated by watching these cosplayers because I really don't get to go to these places, you know, in Japan either. And cosplayers in Japan, cosplayers are cosplayers. They don't really, you know, I mean, I know a lot of cosplayers in Japan, but they like a semi-professional. That's what they do for a living. And in America, people just dress up to go to Comic-Con. That's why I was like really intrigued and fascinated because people just come to Comic-Con dressed up. Like, wow, you know?
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, you do this, you made this, and you, I was just like, I was asking them, I was like fascinated, I was like, I really, really enjoyed it because I wanted to know, how do you guys make these costumes? And some people said they took about a year, and where do you get these ideas? And, you know, I was just interviewing everybody that I saw. It was interesting, you know.
It's like, I know I wrote, you know, most of the music to some of your favorite video games, but tell me how you made that costume. You know?
Yeah, that's what I did. That's what I swear to God, that's how I was like, you know, I'm a composer, but I'm just really curious. You know, okay. Like, and some of the, you know, kids, I don't know what they are dressed up for. I have no idea because I don't play any of those games. So I had to ask, what are you? You know, what are you trying to be? You know, I had to ask them. But some of those are very provocative, and some of those, you know, some very, very interesting, very, wow, it's just like they could get a job in Hollywood, you know, because some of the costumes are like unbelievably good, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
So I was just like really, really curious. I really, really enjoy, it's not really a chore for me because I really enjoy talking to the fans and they really understand. You know, what's, I mean, they are real fans, you know, they like, they know everything about me before I explain to them. They know about me. I'm like, wow, it's crazy.
Right.
it was just like, you know, it's an interesting experience, you know, so I kind of continue to do it because I want to have a TV show with the Comic-Con and with the Hollywood Dream. So I'm just going there just to see, you know, so I could, and also a lot of my friends in Japan want to see what's going on at Comic-Con here in America. So it's kind of interesting, you know?
Right. I think, is this our last question? Okay, well, okay. I'll take this one. Since obviously you're no longer composing music for Konami, are there any other, are you looking to work for any other, like to compose
video games,
basically?
Yeah, definitely. I love to, but I don't know any other video games other than Konami, because I was so loyal and I couldn't work for other companies. So I never really, you know, built a relationship with any other company in Japan or outside. So if anybody wants to hire me, hey, let me know. I'm available, you know?
Right. It's like I posted on Twitter. I was like, you know what, yes. Next, I'm going to make a game. Or maybe I said I was going to make a movie. I'm going to make a movie, and I want you to do the music for it. Plain and simple.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yep.
But I actually get a lot of, Steam game. What's going on with the Steam? I wanted to know about the Steam game. It's like, all sounds like it's a new era. It's Steam game. Steam is so big now. You know, and I actually was introduced to one guy in France, and I think he's making presentation to Microsoft soon. Hopefully he get the funding, and he said he wanted to hire me to do the music. I said, okay, great, you know. So I think the independent guys actually start to make a creative game, and I'm really, you know, I don't care about getting big money for the Konami. I'm more into art. I'm more into, like, I just want to write music for a video game, and somebody's really creating really cool game. I want to be there. I want to write music, you know, for that game, you know? Or film or TV, whatever, you know? Because if you produce, I believe if you create something really, really good, I think people are going to follow it and people are going to buy it. So that's what happened to my whole entire career. It's like, I didn't really think about the money, because I never really thought I could make money doing what I'm doing, you know?
Yep.
Most people do. A lot of people, you know, a lot of people don't think they can make money doing what they love to do. And that's why a lot of people just, they give up. And I know that after Metal Gear Solid 4, you haven't done music for any, at least any big AAA games.
Mm-mm.
But you haven't given up. And I think that's a great thing. And I think it's very important that people realize that, you know.
No, I'm not giving up anything. I'm going to the better, you know, situation than ever. So I'm more free than I have freedom. Thank God that I could create my own video game. I could create my own TV show. I could create my own film or merchandise, whatever, you know. So, you know, it's probably different than most Japanese people. It's like, oh my God, I'm over. You know, I don't think like that. This is my new beginning, my turning point. I could do what I wanted to do. Thank God, you know. So now I'm going to start performing, get back to my musician. And, I was told a lot of fans want to see me, hear me play. So I'm just going to get out there and start playing. You know?
Good.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, you'll have to keep us updated on on music in the future, because I want to hear some of it. And like Daly said, I'm going to release some of that unreleased music.
I got to go into my storage and look for it. And definitely I will. Yeah, I think a lot of fans really be waiting for that. I'll probably sell more that soundtrack than the Metal Gear.
You need to start an iTunes page. That would be perfect.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, that would be great. Absolutely.
Okay. Let's do that. Okay. All right.
All right, guys. So we're going to go ahead and close this out. We've kept her for an hour and a half, and I remember her mentioning that her dog was looking at her like she wanted to go out.
Well, I took her out at 3:30, and it was too hot. She just went 3 blocks, and she wanted to come home. So it was too hot. My dog does not go out when it's raining. My dog does not want to go when it's hot. She's a queen, okay? And she only eats the organic food. So I had to make her food every morning, okay? She's spoiled.
Yeah, I remember you told me the other day that you actually were making her food, and I was like, she eats her dog's food?
I don't even make my own food, okay? She gets her own food every day.
She is spoiled.
Yeah, she is.
That dog probably... that dog probably eats better than 90% of the American population.
Well, I'll say about 99%. I swear to God, she's better than me. Yeah, she really does. She's organic some. I had to go to the store and buy organic fresh salmon. She knows the difference between fresh and not fresh.
Look at that. Now that,
that's crazy.
That is a spoiled dog, man. All right, guys. Well, Rika, it has been an absolute pleasure, and it's been a lot of fun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you guys want to do it again, just let me know. You know. Just,
absolutely.
Just like
yeah, maybe I'll actually be able to make it this time.
Rika, you know me. I will definitely keep in touch with you.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
So
I'll let you guys from next ComCon, which is Utah in August 6th, I believe. And this is I want to help this guy because he said this is his first video game event that he's doing. So I said, okay, I'll just come up, you know.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Okay.
All right.
All right.
All right. Okay.
Thank you so much. All right. Have a great night.
All right. Take care.
You too. Okay. All right. Bye-bye.
Okay.
Bye.
All right, everybody. That was Rika Murinaka. That was actually a very fun interview.
Yeah, that was amazing, man.
First and foremost, I would like to thank our very special co-host, Daily, from the Codec. Thank you very much for being a part of this today.
No problem.
I thought for a minute there I was going to be on my own. I was scared to death, and Daily was prepared to come through for me, and I appreciate that.
Anytime, man, anytime.
All right.
I'm very lost because I came in.
I'll send you the video file, man.
Yeah, only because, I came in like an hour in. And,
yeah. And Daily, I'll send you the video file, too. You can upload it to the Frag Nation page if you want.
Well, I would appreciate that. Thank you.
Did I miss anything like juicy?
Anything groundbreaking?
You did miss quite a bit, but like Gabe said, he'll send you the video. He'll fill you in. There's no sense in us going on through it.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody, the whole four viewers on Twitch, they got to hear it. So
we get more on YouTube.
What's that?
We'll get more on YouTube.
And we'll put it on YouTube, of course. So.